will Zion be redeemed? From the very beginning of the history of the church, when the concept of the building of Zion was introduced, there has been much speculation, much misinformation, and many ideas put forth when and how Zion will be redeemed. The Lord invites the members of the church to search the scriptures and avoid the confusion of speculation. As we seek an answer to our question, we must first of all define the meaning of the term Zion. President David O. McKay said, "Zion means literally a sunny place or sunny mountain. It first designated an eminence in Palestine on which Jerusalem is built. In the Doctrine and Covenants, Zion has three designations. First, the land of America. Second, a specific place of gathering. And third, the pure in heart. Each one of these Doctrine and Covenants definitions given by President McKay will be briefly analyzed. But the redemption of Zion, the specific place of gathering, our city, the New Jerusalem, will be given emphasis. First, let us analyze Zion as the land of America. The prophet Joseph Smith said, "You know, there has been great discussion in relation to Zion, where it is and where the gathering of the dispensation is, and which I am now going to tell you. The prophets have spoken and written upon it, but I will make a proclamation that will cover the broader ground. The whole of America is Zion itself, from north to south, and is described by the prophets, who declare that it is the Zion where the mountain of the Lord should be, and that it should be in the center of the land. When elders shall take up and examine the old prophecies in the Bible, they will see it. The whole of North and South America is Zion. General Moroni also understood this definition of Zion. In Alma 46:17, we read, "And it came to pass that when he had poured out his soul to God, he, General Moroni, named all the land which was south of the land desolation, yea, and in fine all the land, both on the north and on the south, a chosen land and a land of liberty." As the prophet Joseph Smith said, when elders take up the scriptures and prophecies and look at them, they will find that to be the case. When we accept this definition of Zion, we can understand the prophecy spoken of by the ancient prophets in a new light. Let us consider President McKay's second definition, Zion as a specific place of gathering. The Lord revealed to the Latter-day Saints in Doctrine and Covenants 57, verse 3, the specific place of gathering was Independence, Jackson County, Missouri, the place, our center place of Zion. The center place introduces another scripture related to the gathering of the saints. The prophet Isaiah, in chapter 54, verse 2, spoke of enlarging the tent of Israel, of lengthening its cords and strengthening its stakes. At the time of Moses, the tabernacle was a tent which was picked up and carried. It was, in effect, a portable temple. After that time, the concept of Israel being gathered into a tent was familiar among the prophets. The tent of Israel has great importance to Latter-day Saints. No other group in the Christian world uses the term stake, but we speak of the thousands of stakes of Zion. This term has direct reference to the tent of Israel. To set up a tent, particularly a large tent, you must have at least one large center pole held up by cords or ropes secured to stakes driven into the ground. The center pole or the center place cannot be set up until there are stakes established all the way around it. Similarly, Zion must have stakes all the way around the New Jerusalem, Independence, Missouri, before the tent of Israel will be established. We now have many places of gathering, stakes established all around Jackson County, and are coming to the time of establishing a center place. Every state in the United States has one or more stakes, and there are stakes in Canada, Mexico, and Central America. Stakes are also established throughout other parts of the world, but the Lord defined Independence, Missouri, in section 57, as the center of the land which I have appointed for the gathering of the saints, the land of promise, and the place for the city of Zion. Therefore, it seems that the tent concept refers to the Americas and specifically to North America, which was the initial place appointed for the gathering. Now as the church or the tent of Israel is enlarged, it will be necessary, as Isaiah says, to lengthen the cords and strengthen the stakes. The third definition of Zion given by President McKay was the pure in heart. The Doctrine and Covenants in 97:21 describes the people who inhabit the land of Zion as the pure in heart. Earlier, the Lord had given the formula for becoming pure in heart. And this taken from the 88th section of the Doctrine and Covenants says, "And if your eye be single to my glory, your whole body shall be filled with light, and there shall be no darkness in you. And that body which is filled with light comprehendeth all things. Therefore sanctify yourselves, that your minds become single to God, and the days will come that you will see him. For he will unveil his face unto you, and it shall be in his own time, and in his own way, and according to his own will." The people who had gathered to Jackson County, Missouri, and were driven out were commanded to build a temple in Kirtland, Ohio. See Doctrine and Covenants 95, verse 8, where they could work toward perfection and becoming pure in heart. The Lord declared in a revelation to Joseph Smith, DNC 97, verses 13 and 14, that the house of Zion was to be for a place of thanksgiving for all saints and for a place of instruction for all those who are called to the work of the ministry in all their several callings and offices, that they may be perfected in the understanding of their ministry in theory, in principle, and in doctrine, and in all things pertaining to the kingdom of God on the earth, the keys of which kingdom have been conferred upon you. End of quote. Becoming pure in heart is a process. Through the instruction received in the temple and through serving in various callings, the people would have become perfected in understanding. The perfection of understanding and an eye single to the glory of God will help them become pure in heart. The Lord promised that if the temple was built and not defiled, the Lord's glory would rest upon it. Yea, and the Lord's presence shall be there, for he will come into it, and all the pure in heart that shall come into it shall see God. Thus will be fulfilled the beatitude given in the Sermon on the Mount, in Galilee, and in Bountiful among the Nephites: "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." To establish a center place of Zion, the Lord must have a Zion people. Therefore, the place to begin to establish Zion is in the individual. The whole idea of the gospel is to make ourselves pure in heart. Then, when enough people seeking to become pure in heart gather in a designated place, a stake of Zion is established. When a center place is established, surrounded by stakes of Zion, the stakes will be strengthened and the cords will be lengthened to include North and South America and even the whole world as a part of the Zion of our God, as foretold by President Brigham Young. That's Journal Discourses, Volume 9, page 138, if you would like a reference. The Lord promised these blessings to the people gathered in Ohio in 1833. "And now behold, if Zion do these things, she shall prosper and spread herself and become very glorious, very great and very terrible. And the nations of the earth shall honor her and shall say, surely Zion is the city of our God, and surely Zion cannot fall, neither be moved out of her place. For God is there, and the hand of the Lord is there, and he has sworn by the power of his might to be her salvation and her high tower." That's 97th section, verses 18 through 20. Those people failed, therefore this promise is to be fulfilled later. Zion's extension to North and South America and the whole world will not be completely fulfilled until the end of the millennium, probably, but we should work toward this goal. With the restoration of the gospel and the establishment of the church in 1830, the prophet Joseph Smith received numerous revelations for various individuals to seek to bring forth and establish the cause of Zion. You'll find those in the 6th, 11th, the 12th, and the 14th sections, all of them in verse 6. On one occasion, in July of 1839, the prophet said, "We ought to have the building up of Zion as our greatest object. Every dispensation in the history of the world has been given the same commandment to seek to bring forth and establish the cause of Zion. Very few have ever attained it. It will be accomplished in this dispensation, although the early members of the church were given the opportunity and failed. Regarding the city of the New Jerusalem in America, the Lord talked about the day of calling and the day of choosing. The day of calling seems to be the one given to us in section 58 of the Doctrine and Covenants. I'll slide that up in just a moment. The members of the Colesville branch had just moved to the land of Independence, Missouri, the center place of Zion, and were given further information concerning the future glory of Zion. The Lord revealed in verses 3 and 4, "You cannot behold with your natural eyes for the present time the design of your God concerning those things which shall come hereafter, and the glory which shall follow after much tribulation, for after much tribulation come the blessings. Wherefore the day cometh that you shall be crowned with much glory. The hour is not yet, but is nigh at hand." A careful reading shows that the Lord told the saints that they were not going to establish Zion at that time, but that a great period of tribulation yet awaited them. The Lord further stated in verse 6 their purposes in going to Jackson County at this time. Quote, "Behold, verily I say unto you, for this cause I have sent you, that you might be obedient, and that your hearts might be prepared to bear testimony of the things which are to come." It was an individual test for these people to go into Jackson County to see if they would be obedient to the things the Lord had commanded them. Also, it was important that their hearts might be prepared to bear testimony. To establish Zion in the future, the Lord needed individuals who had been there to bear testimony of the land. The second purpose of the saints going to Independence was given in verse 7, that the saints might be honored in laying the foundation and in bearing record of the land upon which the Zion of God shall stand. Though the saints failed to comprehend their immediate purpose in going to the land, they were told that they were only going to lay the foundation of Zion. The third and final reason for sending the saints to Missouri was revealed in verses 8 and 9, quote, "that a feast of fat things might be prepared for the poor, yea, a feast of fat things of wine on the lees well refined, that the earth may know that the mouths of the prophet shall not fail, yea, a supper of the house of the Lord well prepared unto which all nations shall be invited," end of quote. Two questions arrive from this statement. First, what is the Feast of Fat Things? And second, what prophets foretold it? Searching the scriptures reveals that the Feast of Fat Things is the law of consecration and stewardship. It is a law that will bless the poor and eliminate poverty. If you'll read section 42 and 51, you will learn that about the law of consecration. It is a law that will bring about an equality among the saints. Not in the sense that we usually think of equality, but one in which all are equal, as Alma said, because there is no respect of persons as to those who stand in need. It is a law that will allow the saints to prosper and become far more wealthy than those who do not belong to the church. That's Alma chapter 1, verses 30 and 31. It is a law that will be lived in Zion, the only law upon which Zion can be built. The Lord foretold this in section 51, 104, 105, that it was the only law. It is a privilege for the saints, the Lord said to Edward Partridge, to establish this law. When we hear about the law of consecration, our natural reaction is to say, oh, when are we going to have to live that? Remember, it is a privilege. And I'm not going to analyze the law today to show you why, but it certainly is a privilege. What prophets foretold the Feast of Fat Things? Although all of the prophets spoke generally of North and South America, Isaiah was the prophet who specifically foretold of the Feast of Fat Things. He prophesied that the Lord would reign in Jerusalem and in Mount Zion in the latter days, and the strong people would glorify the Lord in Zion. And then in verse 4 of that same chapter, Isaiah 25, he says, "For thou hast been a strength to the poor, a strength to the needy in his distress, a refuge from the storm, a shadow from the heat, when the blast of the terrible ones is as a storm against the wall. Continuing, the law of consecration was to eliminate poverty. The places of refuge for the saints were the stakes of Zion, as the Lord revealed in section 115 and 124, quoting Isaiah. The strangers or Gentiles are to be brought low, Isaiah 25:5 says. And then the Lord said, and in this mountain, or in this mountain of Zion or America, shall the Lord of hosts make unto all people a feast of fat things, a feast of wine on the lees. Fat things full of marrow, of wines on the lees well refined. On this overhead we see a comparison of the Doctrine and Covenants quote and a comparison of Isaiah. You'll note the very close similarity between the two. Isaiah said all people would be invited to the feast. In the Doctrine and Covenants, the Lord said all nations shall be invited. But the invitations are to be extended to the nations in a certain order. In the call issued in 1831, section 58, the Lord said, first the rich and the learned, the wise and the noble. And after that cometh the day of my power. Then shall the poor, the lame, and the blind, and the deaf come in unto the marriage of the Lamb and partake of the supper of the Lord, prepared for the great day to come. The first invited to the feast are the rich and the learned, the Gentile nations of the earth. As recognized in Bible dictionaries, the word nations is often translated Gentiles and vice versa. In the revelation in which he introduced the law of consecration to remember the poor, section 42, verses 30 through 38, the Lord declared in verse 39, for it shall come to pass that which I spake by the mouths of the prophets shall be fulfilled. For I will consecrate, note, the riches of those who embrace my gospel among the Gentiles, unto the poor of my people who are of the house of Israel. There we have identified both the rich and the poor that was quoted earlier. Again, the Lord referred to what he spake by the mouths of the prophets, and he equated the Gentiles with riches. After the rich and the learned are invited, the poor of the Lord's people who are of the house of Israel are to be invited. One purpose of the restoration of the gospel in the latter days given in the preface of the Doctrine and Covenants was that it might be fulfilled which was written by the prophets. The Lord's use of the exact words of the prophets in his revelations to Latter-day Saints is not coincidental. It is given to us to be able to interpret the prophets and to verify the revelation. As Nephi said, in the days that the prophecies of Isaiah shall be fulfilled, then shall men know of a surety at the times when they shall come to pass. As the Colesville branch moved into Jackson County in 1831, the inhabitants of Missouri, the Gentiles, were given the opportunity to come in and accept the gospel and be numbered with Israel and help build Zion. They rejected that opportunity by driving out the saints. When their rejection is full, the fullness of the Gentiles will have come to pass, as foretold in 3 Nephi 16, verse 10, and D&C 45, verse 28 and 29. Nevertheless, the mission of the saints was not a total failure. The Lord said that he had spoken to the saints that the testimony might go forth from Zion, yea, from the mouth of the city of the heritage of God, 58 section verse 13. The mission of the early saints who went to Missouri in 1831 was to bear testimony of the land. They were now qualified to bear that testimony, and that's on the bottom of the quote we had there a moment ago. The saints were driven out of Jackson County in 1833. A revelation was given to them concerning why they had been driven out. They had not been a people who were pure in heart. The revelation says there were jarrings and contentions and envyings and strifes, lustful and covetous desires among them. Therefore, by these things they polluted their inheritances. They were slow to hearken unto the voice of the Lord their God. Therefore the Lord God is slow to hearken unto their prayers, to answer them in the day of their trouble. In the day of their peace they esteemed lightly my counsel, but in the day of their trouble of necessity they feel after me. That's taken from DNC 101, verses 6 through 8. 2 months later, in February of 1834, the Lord gave the early members of the church the opportunity to go back and endeavor to redeem their brethren who had been driven from Zion. See the 103rd section of the Doctrine and Covenants. He decreed then that if they would hearken unto his counsel, they should begin to prevail against mine enemies from this very hour. Also, verse 6 of section 103. Zion's camp was organized to redeem Zion. 4 months later, June of 1834, after they had failed in their attempt, the Lord gave them additional counsel. In that revelation, section 105, he repeats that they had not been obedient, verse 3. They had been full of all manner of evil, they would not impart of their substance to the poor, and they had not been united according to the law of the celestial kingdom, as was required, verse 4. He further stated that the only way that Zion will ever be built up is upon the principle of the law of the celestial kingdom, 105, verse 5. The Lord revealed that his elders must wait for a little season before Zion will be redeemed. He did not define the length of a little season, but outlined 8 things that must be accomplished before that redemption will come to pass. Actually, 9 events must occur. The Lord had revealed another in a revelation previously received, section 103. The Lord promised those who would gather to return to Missouri in Zion's camp that the redemption of Zion must needs come by power. Therefore, I will raise up unto my people a man who shall lead them like Moses led the children of Israel. For ye are of the children of Israel and of the seed of Abraham, and you must needs be led out of bondage by power and with a stretched out arm. The man like unto Moses is the president of the church. These 9 prerequisites then, the first one is that we have a man like unto Moses, who is the president of the church, the president of the high priesthood. That man is the mouthpiece of the Lord, as was Moses. Other men may receive personal revelation, but the one to whom the Lord speaks directly to guide his church is its president. A careful reading of Numbers chapter 12 in the Old Testament would confirm the position of Moses and his successors in our day on that principle. Elder John A. Witzo has verified scripturally that the man likened to Moses is the president of the church. I have the reference for you on the overhead, but let me read his statement. In the early days of the church, persecution raged against the saints in Jackson County, Missouri. For the comfort of the people, the Lord gave several revelations. In one, he promised, I will raise up unto my people a man who shall lead them like as Moses led the children of Israel. DNC 103:16. There have been many conjectures concerning this statement. There have even been misguided men who have declared themselves to be this man like as Moses. Yet the meaning is set forth in the scriptures is very simple. In modern revelation, the president of the church is frequently compared to Moses. Soon after the organization of the church, the Lord said, no one shall be appointed to receive commandments and revelations in this church excepting my servant Joseph Smith Jr. For he receiveth them even as Moses. That's section 28, verse 2. In one of the greatest revelations upon priesthood, this is more specifically expressed. The duty of the president of the office of the high priesthood is to preside over the whole church and be likened to Moses. Section 107, verse 91. The discussion of this question among the saints led to the following statement in the Times and Seasons, volume 6, page 922, by John Taylor, then the editor. The president of the church stands in the church as Moses did to the children of Israel, according to the revelations. The man likened to Moses in the church is the president of the church. End of quote. The Lord will raise up a man who will lead the children of Israel back to build up the city of the New Jerusalem. That man is the president of the church. He may be the present president, President Gordon B. Hinckley, or any one of his successors. So prerequisite number 1 has come to pass, or at least is in place. Doctrine and Covenants section 109 outlines the rest of the 9 prerequisites for the redemption of Zion. That first one would be the second one of the 9. The people must receive and be taught through their temple endowment. The Lord instituted the endowment that the elders themselves may be prepared and that my people may be taught more perfectly and have experience and know more perfectly concerning their duty and the things which I require at their hands. And this cannot be brought to pass until mine elders are endowed with power from on high. That's verses 10 and 11 of section 105. Zion will never be established except by a people who receive and live up to their temple endowment, which is to help them become pure in heart. This revelation was given in 1834, and the Kirtland Temple was completed 2 years later. In 1836, the dedication of the temple on the 3rd of April, 1836, was a great historical incident spoken of by the prophets. The collective outpouring of the Spirit accompanied this dedication, as you will learn by reading History of the Church, Volume 2, page 427 and 28. Yet that endowment of spiritual power does not fulfill the prophecy. Each member must be personally endowed as well. The people must be taught the fullness of the gospel of Jesus Christ more perfectly. Where are we taught more perfectly? In the temple of the Lord. The temple is the Lord's university. I've been teaching that for 20 years or more. I was pleased yesterday at the dedication session number 23. Elder President Faust called it the Lord's university. I'm sure he's not the first one, but it is a degree-granting university, fully accredited. We have the habit of calling BYU the Lord's University. I'm retired, so I can disagree with that. But it is fully accredited in every aspect in which we prepare ourselves for the celestial degree. And that's the one that we all should be working for. Therefore, when the Lord stated that the saints must be taught more perfectly, he is referring to the building of the temple, and the receiving of personal endowments. In the temple endowment, we are instructed how to live, then we covenant to live as we have been instructed. Doing work for our dead also brings us personal blessings of increased knowledge. It is true that we bring our ancestors out of the spirit world. We must vicariously perform their temple ordinances. That is a vital and integral part of the gospel, but we are also beneficiaries because we have a constant reminder of those covenants, better enabling us to know how to live and what the Lord requires at our hands. With this knowledge, we may become a pure people, a Zion people, ready to establish the center place of Zion in the tent of Israel. If the relatively few saints in 1833 who had not received their temple endowment could have redeemed Zion had they hearkened to the Lord, certainly we now have enough temples built and people endowed who are living up to their covenants that Zion could be redeemed if the rest of the Lord's prerequisites are met. The third prerequisite outlined by the Lord for the redemption of Zion is that when the people are prepared, the Lord will fight the saints' battles for them. To the elders of the church, in D&C 105:14, he says, quote, "For behold, I do not require at your hands to fight the battles of Zion. For as I said in a former commandment," D&C 98, verse 37, not in the Revelation, but I insert it, "even so will I fulfill. I will fight your battles." Zion's camp had been offered divine intervention, but had not been faithful. The Lord had told Zion's camp 4 months earlier that from that very day he would give them power to prevail over their enemies. The same promise is applicable to us. From this very day, if we will become the Zion people that we have the potential of being, the Lord will fight our battles. But if we let jarrings and contentions and the designs of the world enter our lives, the Lord will not redeem Zion. We occasionally hear that Heber C. Kimball prophesied that there would not be a yellow dog left to wag its tail in resistance to the saints' return to Jackson County. This prophecy has been tied to another prophecy, that Zion will be swept clean. These are actually two separate prophecies, and should not be linked together. The sweeping clean of Missouri probably has already been fulfilled. During the Civil War, opposing factions called the Bushwhackers and the Jayhawkers battled in Missouri. Through these and other battles, Zion or Missouri was swept clean, leaving only chimneys in place of farms and houses, as Joseph Smith had prophesied to General Doniphan. The Yellow Dog prophecy may be referring to another kind of resistance. The return of specified saints to Missouri will come about in a very natural way. They will have no resistance from the inhabitants. Today, many members live happily in Missouri without resistance. The Lord said He would fight our battles. He will take care of whatever resistance is raised if we trust Him. The fourth prerequisite for redeeming Zion is the establishment of stakes around the center place, as we spoke of earlier. The Lord commanded that as many as have come up hither that can stay in the region round about, let them stay. And those that cannot stay, who have families in the east, let them tarry for a little season, inasmuch as my servant Joseph shall appoint unto them. That's 105 verses 20 and 21. The people dwelling in the regions round about as appointed seems to refer to the establishment of stakes around the New Jerusalem for the center place or center pole of the tent of Israel to be put in place. Earlier, when the members of the church were under great persecution, the Lord had declared in section 101, verse 17, that Zion would not be moved out of her place, notwithstanding her children are scattered. That statement has never been rescinded. Zion will not be removed out of her place. Note again the association with the tabernacle of Moses. The Lord then admonished, 23 and 24 of verse 105, let all my people who dwell in the regions round about be very faithful and prayerful and humble before me, and reveal not the things which I have revealed unto them, until it is wisdom in me that they should be revealed. Talk not of judgments, neither boast of faith nor of mighty works, but carefully gather together as much in one region as can be consistent with the feelings of the people. To understand these instructions from the Lord, not to disclose or boast concerning Zion, we must know the background of what had taken place in 1831. The saints arrived in Independence in the midst of a rough group of settlers living on the frontier, where they could escape across the river if the lawmen came after them. There they boasted of, the saints boasted of building up Zion and implied that they were going to drive out all of the inhabitants. This attitude undoubtedly contributed to their being driven out. The Lord chastised the saints for their behavior and admonished them to go about their future building up of stakes quietly, without conceit, living the gospel, and preparing themselves for the second coming. The Lord instructs the saints further in verse 26 to find favor in the eyes of the people until the army of Israel becomes very great. This is the fifth prerequisite for the redemption of Zion. Estimates of the number of people driven out of Missouri range from 12,000 to 3,000. The total membership of the church is not known. They did not keep the records that we do today. But the lower estimates seem more correct. Still, when we compare even the larger number of 12,000 to our present church membership of about 10 million, we can see that the army of Israel has become very great. We do not know how many soldiers the Lord requires in the army of Israel, but it is obvious that His ranks have grown tremendously. As church membership continues to skyrocket, we need not fear that the Lord will have sufficient men and women to bring to pass His great work of redeeming Zion. The sixth prerequisite of the redemption of Zion concerns the purchase, not conquest, of the land of New Jerusalem. The Lord says, in D&C 105, verses 27 and 8, that He will soften the hearts of the people as He did the heart of Pharaoh from time to time, until His servant Joseph Smith Jr. and his elders, whom He has appointed, will send wise men to fulfill that which I have commanded concerning the purchasing of all the lands in Jackson County that can be purchased and in the adjoining counties round about. The church has very quietly purchased land in Missouri for the last several years. Much speculation has been made about how much land has been bought. But though the amount of land in Missouri that is owned by the church is not generally known, we can be assured that the work is progressing. A few years ago, the governor of Missouri rescinded a decree abolishing the extermination order issued by former Governor Boggs, which stated that no Mormon was welcome in Missouri. This is a noteworthy example of the Lord softening the hearts. Other events have taken place and will yet take place to that same effect in our day. For instance, political leaders and dignitaries of the United States and of foreign countries who come to Utah visit the prophet in the First Presidency. Yesterday in the dedicatory service, Elder Oaks spoke and gave two incidents where that had happened in his office. Though some visits may be mere political moves, nonetheless, they are a recognition of the Kingdom of Zion. There's some politicians that won't even visit Utah. But anyway, again, how much more is required will be known when the Lord reveals it. Earlier, the Lord revealed that the only way Zion will be built up is by purchase or by blood. And if it is by blood, the members would be scourged from city to city. Section 63 of the Doctrine and Covenants. The Lord instructed this, perhaps that's the reason the saints were driven out of Missouri, because there was bloodshed. The later revelation informs the saints to purchase the land. The Lord instructed the saints in other areas to send money to the land of Zion to make those purchases. The faithful would receive an inheritance in Zion. The Doctrine and Covenants section 63 went on to tell them after it said only by purchase or by blood and not by blood. Just as David was forbidden to build the temple because he was a man of war, a man of blood, it seems that we as a people will also be forbidden to enter Zion if we attempt to obtain the land by force, or at least be required to wait for another generation to build the temple. And that will not come to pass. The land in Missouri will be purchased, not conquered. The church and the kingdom of God will become banners to the world. That is the seventh prerequisite. The Lord's army will become very great, it is repeated in verse 31 of section 105, and become pure and holy or sanctified before the Lord, that it may become fair as the sun and clear as the moon, and that her banners may be terrible unto all nations. The banner of Zion, the ensign, the Book of Mormon and the church, the temples that are built, must be waved for the world to see. Eventually, the New Jerusalem would become the banner acknowledged by the Gentiles or the word according, or the world according to Isaiah chapter 60, verse 3. The banner becoming fair as the sun, clear as the moon, is an allusion to the Song of Solomon. Most people are aware that Joseph Smith said the book, the Song of Solomon, was not inspired. And they question, why then is it quoted in the 105th section? The author of the Song of Solomon may have been quoting from somewhere else, a previous revelation, or there may be some things in it that are true, as the Lord said about the Apocrypha. I don't know whether you noted, but in the dedicatory prayer of the Timpanogos Temple, that very same quote was given in asking for a blessing to come upon that temple, and certainly it will be a banner to the world. When this happens, the army of Israel will become great and also become sanctified. The kingdoms of this world will be constrained to acknowledge the kingdom of Zion is in very deed the kingdom of our God and his Christ. Therefore, let us become subject unto her laws. That's 105:32. The character of the people of the church, both individually and collectively, will lead other nations to recognize the hand of God upon Zion. Although this prophecy is not yet fully fulfilled, the recognition of the church and kingdom by the people and nations of the world is coming to pass. The reinstitution of the law of consecration in Zion, the New Jerusalem, is prerequisite number 8. Let's slide that up a little ways here. The Lord commanded the saints to let those commandments which he has given concerning Zion and her law be executed and fulfilled after her redemption. That's 105:34. Those who are called will covenant to live the law of consecration. When they moved to Missouri, the Lord then declared, "There has been a day of calling, but the time has come for a day of choosing," as we quoted before. "And let those be chosen that are worthy." Now note, "And it shall be manifest unto my servant by the voice of the Spirit, those that are chosen, and they shall be sanctified." The day of calling was when the Gentiles were invited to help build Zion in 1831. The day of choosing is the day when the house of Israel will be asked by the Lord to build the New Jerusalem. Some have believed that all the members of the church would leave their homes and go to Missouri. However, that is contrary to the teachings of the scriptures. We cannot establish the center place without having stakes. Those who go to Jackson County will be called through the voice of the Spirit, manifest to the Lord's servant, the man likened to Moses. The call will come on an individual basis, and many people will go to establish the center place of Zion. But there will be multitudes who will not be called. Bear in mind that those who are not called are not necessarily unworthy or less worthy than those who are called. The stakes must be maintained, and leadership will be needed in those stakes. The call to Jackson County is simply a different stewardship that a person will be given for establishing the Zion Society there. Those people will be called and asked to live the law of consecration. Many would willingly accept the call to go to Zion today. The eighth requirement will be met when the man likened to Moses is instructed by the Lord to call those whom the Lord has chosen. The ninth prerequisite requires us to do missionary work in the meantime. The Doctrine and Covenants continues, to sue for peace, not only to the people that have smitten us, but also to all people, and lift up an ensign of peace and make a proclamation of peace unto the ends of the earth. That's 105, 38, and 39. Those who preach the gospel are the publishers of peace, as shown in Mosiah 15, 13 through 18. The Latter-day Saints are to preach the gospel to the world. Today we have about 50,000 missionaries in many countries of the world. Still other countries are being prepared by the Lord. Missionary work will continue into the millennium, and the Lord will proclaim when enough people have heard the gospel message for Zion to be established. Of the nine prerequisites outlined by the Lord for the redemption of Zion, all have been met to one degree or another, and many saints are prepared to meet further requirements. To prepare for the redemption of Zion on an individual basis, we must make ourselves a Zion people, live the principles of the gospel to fulfill our temple covenants, and preach the gospel to all the world. May we prepare ourselves and become a Zion people, pure in heart. I bear testimony that Zion will be built, and that these nine prerequisites are essential for that building, and they will be fully met as the Lord directs. May we be individually a part of those. I pray and bear testimony in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
A set of four video cassettes featuring eight lectures from the 1996 Sperry Symposium, Doctrine and Covenants, A Book of Answers, is available from the BYU Creative Works catalog by calling 1-800-962-8061 or visit us online at the address on your screen. The cost is $29.95 plus shipping and handling.